thanks to the five of you for being here as well. The American people are blessed to have an IC that's as serious as ours is. We have a lot of a gazillion patriots and some actual heroes in the community, and the five of you care deeply about the mission and about leading those folks and celebrating them. So I just want to say, since most of our time in this committee is spent in an oversight capacity, which is in private, we don't get the chance to say in front of the American people enough thank you to the entire intelligence community, and particularly the five of you who are leaders. Director Haynes, I also want to praise your statement. I think that your opening statement on behalf of the whole community today was incredibly strong. I want to highlight a couple of pieces, but I want to admit that in a way I'm just riffing on where Chairman Warner opened, that when you do an around the world threat assessment of what the challenges are that we face, and I think Marco, the Vice Chairman, said something very similar when he, I think his riff was more than 90% of all the intelligence and national security challenges the American people and our troops face around the world, more than 90% of them originate in the five bad guy category of long-term tech race with the Chinese Communist Party, Russia sowing disinformation and corruption and cyber attacks abroad, Iranian nukes and sponsorship of terrorism abroad, North Korean nukes, and a grab bag of jihadis. Those five things are the five big threats we face. There aren't two, and there aren't really 20 that need to be on that top tier list. There are five. But one of the things that's new, I think, in the last 4 to 6 years is a real consensus in your community and on this committee in a bipartisan way that there is an unparalleled number one threat. The five things are not equal. The long-term technology race we face with China is the biggest existential national security threat we face. And I think Chairman Warner did a great job of distinguishing between Chairman Xi's command and control tyrannical system and his party. But that's not the same as the Chinese people. That's not the same as Chinese expats. That's not the same as Asian Americans abroad. And we have to, together, the IC and this committee in a bipartisan way, has to make sure we communicate again and again to the American people that there is one overarching national security threat we face, and it is not race-based. It is not Chinese Americans. It is Chairman Xi and his cronies and what they want to do to try to dominate the world and oppress people, most acutely the Uyghurs, but lots and lots of people in their own country and abroad. And so I think it's important just to underscore some of the things, Director Haynes, you said on behalf of the entire community. You said that the threat we face from China is unparalleled. It's not the same as North Korea, as big a deal as that is. It's not the same as Russian nefarious actions abroad. China is increasingly a near-peer competitor. China will maintain its major innovation and industrial policies because Chinese leaders see this strategy as necessary to reduce dependence on foreign technologies, enable military advances, and sustain economic growth, and thus ensure the CCP's survival. Chairman Xi is not about the good of his people. He's not about the good of 1.4 billion Chinese people. He's about the good of his party and the way they oppress their people. You also said that China is trying to promote new international norms for technology and human rights, emphasizing state sovereignty and political stability over individual rights. You said that China will remain the top threat to U.S. technological competitiveness as the CCP continues to target technology sectors, et cetera. So I think it was a very strong statement, and as a part of what happens, the majority of not just our committee's work, but the majority of this hearing is in private today. But as far as something we put before the American people, that's an incredibly strong opening statement. So I want to commend you and the whole interagency process that got it there. I'd like to follow up on your response, though, to Senator Casey's comment about the fact that I'm putting a finer point on it, but in 2018, Congress passed a new law about export controls, and the goal is to be sure that we update what emerging and foundational technologies we regard as needing to be restricted to the CCP. Obviously, the CCP is also involved in a massive technology theft, IP theft project, but just at the level of export controls, a law was passed in 2018, and it's largely unimplemented. And I think former Chairman Burr made the good point that in 5G, we should view the Five Eyes as allies that we would use to build the technology base, whether it's a D10 or a D12 or whatever the strategy is. We need something like the TPP again that says freedom-loving nations that believe in open navigation of the seaways, free trade, the rule of law, transparent contracts, human rights, etc. We need an alliance of freedom-loving peoples against the CCP's nefarious sponsorship of stuff like surveillance state tyranny abroad. But to do that, we have to have clarity about what those critical technologies are. So I would love to hear some public explanation for the American people of when will we have the 2018 law implemented, and probably more 30,000-foot view, more importantly, if we're going to build an alliance of freedom-loving nations in this technology race, how can we do it? How can we lead allies if we don't have clarity for ourselves about what those critical technologies are?
Thank you, Senator. Maybe I'll just start and welcome my colleagues joining on this. I think just to focus in on the intelligence relationships in particular and the 5I point that you and Senator Burr are making. I mean, I think it will not surprise you that technology is one of the things that we intend to talk to them about, that we are already talking to them about at different levels. And I think it is entirely right to be focused on the idea that among the Five Eyes, we can actually do some good work together, in effect, in addressing this issue that we none of us can do alone in a way, and that that's a place where we do need to focus. I think there is also, it is true that the policy community is working, and I know the administration is working on a strategy on these issues that would include partners and would effectively focus on the kind of issues that you're describing. In addition, they are also looking at the technology sectors and how it is that you approach each of these to deal with whether or not de-linking in all of these different spaces is the right thing to do and how to do it so that you don't actually have collateral impact that sometimes can have negative consequences in those areas. But why don't I leave it to others to comment?
Senator, I would just say from a DI perspective and the Department of Defense, our closest partners are Five Eyes teammates. I have deep personal relationships with every one of my counterparts. We talk on a weekly basis. And from a strategic competition perspective or an intelligence support aspect to strategic competition, they're all in. And so this conversation about identifying the technology and how we can collectively get after this threat with the CCP, I think they are ready for that conversation.
Yeah, I think, Senator, I would just add, you know, from our competitive advantages, think about what are our competitive advantages for the nation, for the intelligence community, whether that's artificial intelligence, big data, machine learning, space. All of these are critical capabilities that have far-reaching implications, not only for our economy, but obviously for the security of our nation as we take a look at where we're going in the future as well.
I mean, I'll just say the chair and the vice chair want to compliment Senator Sasse for agreeing with the chair and the vice chair.
It's always helpful, yes.
Anybody else more? Because we're kind of clocking.